Hi everyone, it's great to be here in Manchester. I love Manchester. I used to come here all the time. Before I had a child, I used to come here and go out all the time. And it's great to hear Ian read, and I'm looking forward to hearing Jen. Can you all hear me? Okay. So I'll start by reading from a poem from Chick, then I'll read some from Chan. I should probably say that Chick and Chan are both nicknames of my late father, who was, he had another nickname as well, he was Chick, Chan and Chin, and they were all gambling nicknames. He was a kind of notorious gambler, my dad, and his cronies would phone up and ask for him by those names. I never really knew what they meant as a child. Just I didn't really understand how my dad had ended up in Ilford, Essex, all the way from Jamaica. He was half black Jamaican and half Chinese. And I think as a kid also, I used to think like my Chinese grandfather in Jamaica, I guess I thought like he was like the only Chinese guy in Jamaica, like he's taken a wrong turn or something. Although I now know there's quite a lot of Chinese people in Jamaica. This first poem is really, I suppose it's about, I guess it's about shame and the fact that I was often asked as a child, is that your dad? Because we looked so different, you know, I look so white, I guess. And, but really, it's also about the shame of dancing. I'm sure there's many people here, perhaps girls more than the women more than the men, who may have done ballet as a child. I don't really know why I persevered at ballet for so many years, but I was like the tallest ballerina. I was 5'6" when I was 8 or something. But, dance class. The best girls pose like poodles at a show, and Betty Finch, in lemon gauze and wrinkles, swept her wooden cane along the rows to lock our knees in place and turn our ankles. I was a scandal in that class, big-footed giant in lycra, joker in my tap shoes, slapping on the offbeat while 100 tappers hit the wood. I miss the cues each time. And after, in the foyer, Dad, a black man, stood among the Essex mothers clad in leopard skin. He'd shake his keys and scan the bloom of dancers where I hid and whispered to another ballerina, he's the cab driver my mother sends for me. You say it's often said that poem sometimes sounds like it's my dad that was clad in leopard skin, but it's not, it's the Essex mothers in leopard skin. So I'll read now poems from Chan. And I suppose that if Chip was a book really about the mystery around my dad, then Chan is a kind of book of research when I tried to find out some of the answers. And I found out from a notebook that he had left that he had travelled from Jamaica to Liverpool in 1947, and I found out the name of the ship. And I also found out that he had a very, very difficult relationship with his father, his Chinese father who raised him, quite a violent relationship. And that in part might have accounted for his reasons for wanting to leave Jamaica. But as well as the fact that Jamaica after the Second World War was really impoverished, and the chance fact there were ships that were sailing from Jamaica to the UK, and also the fact that my dad was raised as a colonial subject and believed the British Empire was his and that Britain would welcome him. So this poem, it's in four stanzas, and each stanza takes the idea of leaving, the planning to leave, then the journey, and then arrival. It's in the voice of a man like my dad, speaking at that time in history. And it takes gambling, I guess, as a metaphor. I mean, what better metaphor is there for migration than gambling, the idea of swapping one hand of cards for another. So you'll hear lots of gambling references. It's also a glosser, this poem, which means that it takes four lines of someone else's poem as a structuring principle. Each line finishes each of the four stanzas. So the lines that I've borrowed come from a Theodore Retke poem called The Waking, and I'll read them to you. This shaking keeps me steady, I should know. What falls away is always and is near. I wake to sleep and take my waking slow. I learn by going where I have to go. What I know. At night, you find me at the oil lamp, dice in hand. I say to myself, if I throw a pair of fives, I'll give up this life. The hot, slow days of hurricanes, sweet reek of banana rock, black fruit on the vine. I want another hand of chances. I grip the dice and blow a gust of luck into my fist. I'm dreaming of England, yes. Work, yes. Women, riches. I shake these bone cubes hard, let go. This shaking keeps me steady, I should know. The radio fizzes news across the tenement yard. Days soldiers sailing home, a weekend parade, monsoon time coming. I pass dead horses in the field, dead mules. Men sag like slack suits in the square. Talk of leaving starts like rain, slow and spare, a rattle in a can. My tears aren't for the ship, new places, strange people, but the loss of my always faces. I mean my people, who I know, my places. My sister says, you carry them with you, don't fear. What falls away is always and is near. The ship rocks steady across the ocean. You ever look out to sea, on every side is sky and water, too much, too blue. Thoughts lap at me like waves against the bow, not where I am, but why and who. At night, we use our hours up. 10 fellows flock to someone's sticky room. I roll my dice or deal the shemmy, brag pontoon. We go till dawn, a huddle at the lamp turned low. I wait to sleep and take my waking slow. Some fellows swore there were diamonds on these streets. Look hard enough in rain and you'll see them. I squint my eyes, but what I see is sunshine on the dock. My sister's white gloves waving me goodbye. There's no diamonds here, but if there are, they're under a skin of snow. Seems the whole world's gone away. I roll my dice in basements below these English pavements. I guess I'm learning what I need to know. I learn by going where I have to go. I'll move back into the nearer history, I guess, now, and return to the idea of what people thought about my dad when I was younger. And when I went to university, I fell in with a crowd of students, like white kids with dreadlocks, if you know the sort, who all really loved reggae music, particularly dub reggae. And I went out with one of these students for quite a while, all the way through university, in fact. And when they found out that my dad was Jamaican, I got quite a lot of cred for that. So I never really let on that he disapproved of Rastafari. Like, he left Jamaica. There were Rastafarians, but reggae music certainly didn't exist in the way that it did later. And, you know, like a lot of older Jamaicans, Rastafarians were considered to be kind of lazy, good for nothings. So the idea that they would have equated him with that would have, like, probably offended him, but made me popular, so I get to go. So in this poem you'll hear, I'll mention a lot of reggae artists. I'll mention a guy called Adashanti, who ran this amazing sound system in Vauxhall. You can still go to the Adashanti sound system. If you want your eardrum that John's blown, it's now at King's Cross. I know I'm getting old because I read this poem at a thing last year, and afterwards this young man came up to me with really long dreadlocks, and he goes, oh, there was someone I know, you mentioned someone I know in that poem. And I said, who? And he went, Abishanti. I went, really? Yeah, he's my dad. Whoa. Reggae story. My father liked the blues and Lady Day. He left Jamaica way before the reggae rocked all night in Backstreet Studios, before King Tubby or Augustus Pablo. But I used to love a boy who loved dub reggae, loved thick lugs of ganja, loved on Sunday nights to cross the river. Take me to the house of roots and Abashanti in the cobbled arches under Vauxhall, where the Lion of Judah decked the walls and stacks of speakers pumped electric bass, a single bulb above the smoky haze, and on the stage a little dreadlock man like Rumpelstiltskin shouted jar and spun his blistering tunes on a single turntable, and shut-eyed men called back over the vinyl, jar Rastafari. Next door, the old guys were like wizened goats with yellow eyes, hunched over games of chess and ginger tea, below the golden-framed Haile Selassie, King of Kings. That boy didn't know my father was a white-haired, godless pensioner, whose reggae music never really got me until I played it on my own. Bob Marley, Uroy, Johnny Clark, and even then it came to me like hymns, like Fauré's Requiem, Vivaldi's Gloria. That boy thought I had a Rasta like Prince Farai for a dad, not the silent island man who sat beyond the bedroom door I'd listen at to catch a woman crooning down a melody, "I can't give you anything but love, baby." I'll finish with one poem, staying on the theme of music, and to which say that I've absolutely loved listening to the music at the beginning. And this poem is about my dad's cousin, Jo Harriet, who's now probably considered to be the forefather of avant-garde jazz in Europe, but was very much neglected in his lifetime. He was Jamaican born, came to Britain, and played in a lot of the jazz clubs in the 50s and 60s, which is where, rather confusingly, my mum met him, and that's how my parents met each other, because my mum went out with Jo for a good few years before she got together with my dad. Anyway, if you talk to my mum about Jo Harriet, she'll always say how much she loved the music. She'll often break into song, but the air often turns blue, because someone said about Jo Harriet, if alto saxophonists had been genetically made a million years ago like a beaver, then that's what Jo was, a saxophonist. He wasn't really a person. So music was everything. Probably drink came next, and then maybe women. The title of the poem is Cherokee, which is a jazz standard that my mum loved Jo's versions of. And you'll hear, it's in my mum's voice. So when I say my mum, I mean my nan. And my nan was a right old racist. That's an important thing you have to remember, that my nan really disapproved of Jo. It's got a little epigraph. I was playing with fire, bet love. Cherokee. He phoned me up, a party, would I go? My mum said, "Jo, who's Jo? A darkie? No, not on your nelly, lady. No, you won't you. Peach lipstick, lacquered beehive, tweed Miss Perfume." I took the bus. Of course there was no party, just a room with whiskey glasses on the bedside and fag ash on the tangled sheets at dawn. Or we could play an ace could Jo, the Aki Blues and Cherokee. Da 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 da. He put his sax in hot to pay the rent, said, "Betty, can you help me?" Had a pound off me on Sunday night. He had it bad, he said. He'd not been with another girl in weeks. And no, my mother didn't sleep a wink. She sobbed into her mixing bowl. Then off we went to Auntie Connie's caravan. He wore his suit and wingtips on the dunes. He said he loved me in the spinning teacups, then vanished in the night. Oh, we knew a tune, that bastard ass old drunk. The Aki Blues and Cherokee. Da, 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 da. And no, I couldn't bring him home for Christmas over my dead body, lady. He came with flick knife smile and lilac bath cubes, and oh, she sobbed into her mixing bowl. My father walked into the tube, came home and stank of whiskey, said, "He's just like any other fella, ain't he, Betty? Ain't he?" Thanks for listening.